New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to New Arts Alive. And with me, I have my guest, is Dean Radinovsky. And Dean is a painter. And Dean, what I would like you to do to begin tonight is sort of give a scenario of what generally you do as far as painting, so that they have sort of an insight as we go along, instead of trying to do that insight all the way through.
I generally work on many things at once, many different series. The three main series are large abstract paintings, which are often around 7 by 9 feet. Another series is bather paintings. And then a third series, which is always going on, are very small postcard paintings, which develop through the mixing of the paint and using the postcards as palettes for separate batches of color, and also just playing with the paint and using the paint up at the end of the session. But I also often work on other things. For instance, the show at the program now, Project Wall, is just a really good excuse to do something totally different and experimental. Sometimes I use shows to force myself to edit a video, or in this case, with the Project Wall, I'm combining photography, video, and painting. But I like to just always experiment and always try to wrap my experiments into the next pieces and sort of develop a technology of contemporary art.
Okay, Dean, shall we move into one image so that we can work from that?
Sure, yeah.
Is this ready to?
It's ready, yeah.
There it is.
This is one of the large abstract paintings. And this is actually an earlier stage. It's moved on since this. This started out vertical and it moved horizontal. And it's just very much of an abstract
painting. How large is this that you have in the screen?
7 feet by 9 feet.
Okay, that's the total of it.
Yeah, yeah.
Very loose, fluid paint, right?
Yeah, and I wanted to leave a sort of a sense of airy openness. Some of my earlier paintings are very dense, so this has some amount of open space, and you can actually see the purplish form was really just poured onto the painting. I set the painting off the wall onto the floor and just manipulated the paint while the painting was on the floor. And then to create the drip effect, I just lifted the painting up, which I often do. I'll just control a drip and then have to let it dry for a long period of time. That paint was Galkid resin, and it's actually still tacky after over a year.
Well, sort of like oil paint, which can go on forever, depending how thick it is.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, years and decades.
Yeah. As for the content, I really just develop an image from the very beginning. When I start gessoing, I'll start working with color because I find gessoing kind of tedious. So I'll start working with color, and the form begins from the process, the very beginning of the process. And sometimes I'll respond to something in my environment, but then eventually it'll just be responding to the painting and trying to make it work.
This is oil painting, so consequently when we're speaking about drying time, it takes time.
Yeah, it takes a lot of time. And right now, one of the studios that I have has no heat, so I don't think it's going to dry until the spring, the stuff that I'm working on now.
You have a new, whole new thing happening.
Yeah, so you get to, it's an opportunity to really work with the wet paint indefinitely, almost. You have to see it as an opportunity.
You just finished this past week, or 2 weeks. It's something that you do periodically during the year. It helps you financially support your work. Tell the audience just a little about...
Yeah, I was just working on New York Fashion Week, which is actually about 3 weeks of work. But I do lighting, and I actually have access to backstage, and I've been able to photograph and do some video of the models. So they've actually become characters in some of my artworks, and I've used their portraits as well as portraits from models that I've recruited on my own in this current project wall. But that environment is so compelling, and you're just so surrounded by beauty and exoticism that I really enjoy engaging in that element of the work, and it really makes me want to continue doing that work.
It's kind of busy, isn't it? I mean,
it's extremely busy. And if I want to do the extra, I've been doing drawings also. I have to, like, any time I would otherwise have a free moment, I have to sort of still continue the work of, like, the artistic side. And luckily I work with people that know me well enough to understand what I'm doing and let me do it.
Get you carried away, huh?
Yeah, but it's really nice to work an artistic side into the money-making side of my life.
So your studio, you have a studio in Manhattan, don't you?
Not anymore.
You don't?
I get subsidized studio space, and I've been getting them through Chashama, a group that specializes in providing visual artists and performing artists with cheaper space. And recently they've hooked me up with a space in Far Rockaway. That's the one with no heat. So it's a big space. It was built to be a commercial space, but it hadn't been used by anybody for 40 years. So Danny Lietzel, Barry Rosenthal, and I now have this space for the time being. We're not sure how long we'll have it, but it's a big space. It's cold, but...
but it gets warmer in the summer.
It'll get warmer in the summer. It'll get hot in the summer. It's very workable, though. So I'm working on big stuff right now.
Do you use an air conditioner in the summer or
a fan?
A fan?
Yeah.
Move it around?
Yeah.
Okay, that. Let's move on to another image.
This is another in the series of large abstract paintings. And you can see from this that I'm not a hard-boiled abstractionist who tries to keep all imagery out of the work. But I generally think of myself as an abstract painter just because of the way that I like to manipulate space and think of space not as sort of a non-Euclidean entity.
Almost everybody is an abstract person because about the only thing you could do is paint it exactly as it is or photograph it as it is. I mean, that by interpreting, you're a form of abstraction.
Yeah, I guess it's nothing new. But I've done a lot of still life in the past, and it's part of my vocabulary, so I'm happy to fold it into in otherwise abstract painting.
How large is this?
This is another one that's 9 by 7.
That's
feet.
Pretty standard size, 9 by 7.
Yeah,
The project wall is
8 by 14.
It's a little larger.
Yeah.
Giving you a different perspective on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, the project wall, Dean has been working since the beginning of January, and it goes for 12 weeks, and that will be in around the 12th or 13th of April, I believe, something like that.
Yeah.
And it's an ongoing thing. It's about process, not an end product, which when you go to an exhibition, basically, you're seeing an end product or the results of an act. And so it's a different kind of challenge.
Yeah, I love working this way because it's very similar to how I work in the studio.
I have heat.
Yeah, you have heat. It's fantastic. But
do you title your work?
Yeah, this piece is called Saint's Place. And the title comes from sort of my feelings and interpretations about Bellini's, the space that's in Bellini's St. Francis in the Desert that's at the Frick. And that's really the inspiration for this painting. Most viewers interpret this as something completely different. They often see a female figure. But that's fine with me. I think that there's an underlying feeling about the painting that will be conveyed, and everybody will interpret it differently. It's never really important to me to sort of control what the viewer thinks about a work.
Well, it's an idea, and that idea is a dialogue, hopefully.
Yeah. I think it was Brock who said that the painting is finished when the original idea has been effaced. And I like that. Because a lot of times your initial literal idea is really just leading to something that's inside of you. The initial idea, sometimes it even, once you've developed a painting, it's preventing you from actually finishing the painting. And when you break from that idea, what's actually been percolating in your subconscious is able to come through in an expression.
I sort of think of making work as taking, before you finish something, you never do, you take a little bit, becomes the sort of the stimulus for the next one,
mm-hmm.
or the next ones. Whatever it is.
Absolutely, yeah.
Because it's kind of difficult starting out creating a wheel each time.
Yeah.
Reinventing the wheel, so to speak.
That's why I like to use the word technology when I talk about art. I mean, a lot of the technologies painters use, it's real technology, it's real understanding, and it's development of something like even a seed, the oil from a seed, to use that in a painting, that's technology. So all paintings are technological, but also when we build our own personal vocabulary, that's sort of our technology that we can draw on for all of our works. But yeah, I definitely am always looking to feed one thing into the next, and especially with the postcard paintings, with a lot of...
Do you have some of those?
Yeah, I have a couple of those.
Okay.
A lot of that stuff is kind of aggressively experimental, and I'm always kind of want to unify everything into one unified statement.
Good luck.
It's never going to happen, especially when you see a couple of the other series that I'm going to show you. They're very different. The styles of painting, or the techniques of painting and the palette are often quite similar, but the subject matter is very different.
Let's bring up another one.
This is called Cheshire, because it reminded me of the Cheshire cat.
Is that a breed, or is it?
It's the cat from Alice in Wonderland. Oh, that okay. Is the disembodied floating smile.
Okay.
I wish the viewers could see this in person, because it's difficult to photograph. It's another 9 foot high by about 7 feet wide. I think these are actually 8'10" by 7'6", but
it's close.
Yeah. It's very simple. Used a big stencil. And
do you generally work on canvas, or do you work on wood, board?
Usually canvas. Smaller pieces, I like to work on wood. Postcards are actually on postcards, and then I mount them on little pieces of plywood just so they
become a little more fixed.
Yeah, a little more fixed, a little more permanent. And also so you can show them like a painting instead of behind glass.
Are your postcards about the size of those? Years ago they had those where you would put the image in there, the two images, and you would see the three-dimensional. What did they call it?
Stereoscope?
Those? Yeah. Do you see them in some way like that?
Not really. I'd never actually never thought of that, but maybe I could do a series.
Well,
make
you know,
a 3D effect.
Yeah. Because you're making them small and they would almost fit in.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good idea. Yeah, I mean, part of the impetus behind that is to, especially in the late 90s and early 2000s, those boxes in bars and restaurants near the bathrooms, they would have a box of postcards, and they were all advertisements. And it was part of the boom of advertising, which is continuing today, where everywhere you go, you're confronted by something that you haven't chosen to see. Somebody else has chosen for you to see it. So I like to subvert the commercial aspect of advertising by painting on it. And sometimes I'll use the meaning of the ad and subvert it, and that'll be the point of the painting. A lot of times it just gets totally covered up and it becomes an abstract painting, but it makes me happy to subvert that aspect of advertising.
Well, this one you can't hold, 7 by 9 feet. The postcard you can hold.
Yeah, it's a very intimate piece. And you kind of want to be able to see it up close. If it works the whole way across the room also, then I find it's a very successful painting, but it should also draw you in to within a couple inches.
You want to give us another?
Yeah. This is an unfinished painting, but this was actually taken with my iPhone. It's not a bad shot. But this is still in progress. It's called Plaster Sun Redaction, which the title is basically about as abstract as the piece. It's kind of like inspired by poetry.
Do you name them before you start them, or do you name them as you make them, afterwards?
I would say the majority of the time I name them afterwards, because something in the painting will suggest itself to me. Or when I'm getting ready for a show, the title will just pop into my head, and that's when the painting is finished. With this one, just the upper left quadrant reminded me of a plaster sun, and the gray horizontal reminded me of something that had been redacted from a document, as if it's covering something up. Or
I've seen some of your pieces which are it's a mass of pigment. Mm-hmm. I don't know how else to say it. It's a blob. So
yeah.
To speak, and But in your large paintings, they have more of a translucent quality, transparent quality to them, or they become larger, suggest somewhat a larger quality. But then when you were somewhat explaining this, it sort of suggested somewhat of those kind of blob qualities that you, even that's what I interpret from what you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that's a whole other body of work. The pieces that are essentially sculptures that are developed out of the painting
object,
process.
Yeah.
But these larger pieces, I think the history of my painting has been quite dense. A lot of the work has been dense, so I'm trying to get some more open spaces into the work. And the lower left quadrant of this painting really has a sense of a void. So a lot of it is still just the acrylic underpainting. Well, all the paintings that I do, I start in acrylic. Like I start with the gesso, I start toning that, and then
Is it usually white?
I get bored with white, so I start adding colors, often by quadrant. That's why some of these have a quadrant shape, or sometimes there are six shapes, just because I can't gesso the whole thing at once or it'll dry. So I gesso a quarter at a time, and then I'll start toning the quarters, and some of those shapes remain in the painting sometimes.
Well, the Impressionists were the ones that were first to use a white surface.
Mm.
Goya used a lot of red,
mm-hmm.
orange, underpaint.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because he used a lot of grays and on top, so it was an element of building.
Yeah, definitely.
And the Impressionists, pretty much. And it's can get boring. But I've seen the Daniel Smith. He has a gesso that's gold.
Mm-hmm.
And I went on, I couldn't, he won't communicate on the phone.
Mm-hmm.
The business does it by, you have to either email or, but they don't have it online anymore, the gold. It was incredible.
One company that's good, that'll really talk to you, is Golden.
Oh, Mark, yeah.
They're good, they're really good at explaining things, explaining the properties.
That's his whole process of the business.
And they bought Williamsburg paint, and they're also very generous with information. Like they stopped making intense black because it dried too slow. But I liked that, so I called them up and asked if they would make it again. And they were like, sure, we'll reformulate it for you. It just cost $25 extra. And then I asked about alizarin yellow, because they changed their formula again. It wasn't performing the same way. So I asked, and the woman actually gave me the formula for the original. She was like, we could mix it for you, but it costs you $25. Instead,
she'll tell you how to do it.
Yeah, it's like two parts Indian yellow plus one part Stille de Grand. So save $25. But they're a really nicely communicative and helpful and accountable company.
Yeah, his father was the chemist. And back when Beaucourt had his uncle, I believe, his mm-hmm. uncle. And Mark's father was a chemist for him. And he had, he made from a oil acrylic, which is that Morris Lewis used. But that's a deadly thing.
Mm-hmm.
Morris Lewis was painting in a ranch, small ranch house,
Wow.
Outside of D.C. Mm-hmm. He smoked like a fiend. And I doubt if he had any ventilation. He died at 49.
Wow.
I stopped using it because it started giving me headaches. Mm. It's still, but Mark still makes it golden. They use it for conservative, conservatory work and that. Not, I mean, you can use it, but you got to have ventilation.
Yeah.
I mean, real ventilation. You got to have ventilation just for water acrylic, though.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a myth that you can.
I would assume everything is toxic.
It is.
I always wear gloves, and even underneath the gloves, I wear I put on the liquid glove type stuff, this hand cream, because sometimes the gloves break.
I still have some of the rope, the oil acrylic clear. I have it in a jar, a little of it. I just look at it. Shall we move on to another image?
So these are all, they all start with acrylic.
Undercoat.
Yeah, and eventually it does become part of the painting. It becomes like washy acrylic, and then I go over it with oil. But sometimes I leave the acrylic. You can see some of it sometimes. This is a view of the studio in Far Rockaway. So I'm able to work on four big paintings right now. These are about how they look now. They're all unfinished. I've got a multi-panel painting there on the right. And it's a great, I'm looking forward to the summer when it's warmer.
Well, the project wall, you can work out all your innovations and get ready for that big jump.
I think the next piece has some nudity in it, so viewers beware. This is one of my series of bathers paintings. All of the figures in this series come from either internet erotica or like Sports Illustrated swimsuit magazines or some kind of commercial utilization of the female figure. So this is another thing where I want to recontextualize something that surrounds us in society and basically put the figures into like a primordial landscape, and also kind of put them back in time into the tradition of bather paintings.
Well, Botticelli with his seashell, you know, with the
Venus, the Birth of Venus paintings, and Renoir's nudes. Definitely, it continues a line. This painting, I eventually...
What size is it?
This is about 2.5 feet high, so it's smaller.
Compared to the...
Yeah, it's a medium-sized painting. But the characters in this painting really developed a lot, and they really became their own people. One of them is almost kind of a ghost, like ghostly. So they really... almost like characters in a story. You hear authors talk about how they don't really know what their characters are going to do or what path the story is going to take. The figures in these bather paintings also really develop their own stories and personas.
Right here you have it almost like the figure. You can see the legs or the reflection one way or the other.
Yeah. And these involve probably hundreds of layers of paint. It's very, very, very thinly painted over a couple years. So it's another very slow series, slowly developing series. Most of my paintings, even the postcard paintings, sometimes will develop over several years.
Is it that somebody takes it away from you, that you stop?
If somebody buys it, then I'm not going to argue with that. But it doesn't really help. It doesn't happen often enough to halt progress on very many paintings. But I think not having, well, I don't have the pressure of mounting a gallery show once a year for any of these series. So I do work on the paintings for years. And I think that makes the paintings much better. Like after a few years or a few months, you haven't touched a painting and you look at it again, you can often figure out what to do with it to make it better. And if you have years, then you have several chances.
It's like a good wine.
Exactly,
it's
yeah.
It's time.
This sort of comes out of my years painting in Maine, the Maine rockscapes. These are all, the figures are stenciled. So I'll take a photo and cut it out, make a stencil, and then just print flesh tone paint on the background. Yeah. So once they're stenciled, everything else is invented. So really nothing is observed at this point. But I've done painting from observations.
Is the rock there, or what is suggestive of a rock, or that mass, is that a cutout too?
No, that's
just the form.
Just the forms, yeah. But years of painting from life. I still paint from life. I go upstate and paint the landscape, and I've been painting around Rockaway a little bit. So all the works are informed by that practice. I enjoy doing it. I use the other side of the cutout to create negative space in monotypes. So these are oil on unprimed paper, and they're printed with saran wrap.
Sort of like a silhouette type of.
Yeah, a silhouette and also an absence. I actually started doing these after my mom died, and I did not think about it at all, but I definitely think that there's a connection. And also that my mother was married to my father for 20 years, and then she ended up, her final relationship was a long-term relationship with a woman. So the multiple women definitely are part of my life story. And also I think that the idealization, the physical idealization of the women are parallel to the ideal of my mother's relationship with my stepmother, because they were just, they had like an ideal and very loving relationship. So when I realized that I was sort of painting a contemporary ideal of body type, it kind of made me laugh that it sort of matched the ideal of their relationship, like just the beauty of their love. And it's a way that, all of that is a way that people don't really look at models or...
They don't have your experience.
Yeah. People have difficulty looking at commercialized females in a different way or a deeper way, or in a way that reminds them of different elements of humanity. And that's part of what these paintings have become. The monotypes are also an ongoing abstract and sometimes figurative practice. This is another spin-off. I want to turn this into a t-shirt.
I was going to say it's almost a fabric quality too.
Yeah, these are painted cutouts, and I just placed a shirt on top of them and then scanned it. But I'd like to have the fabric printed onto fabric and as something you could wear.
The surface of the figures, the body surface, is like a canvas that the color was applied to it, and it was sort of bleached so that it has no edge except the outline.
Yeah, that's the printing process.
It makes it become more translucent, that part.
Yeah. Yeah, that has to do with printing with the Saran wrap, which I cover my palettes with the Saran wrap. I think we talked about this before, the last time I was here, that when I picked the wrap up off of the paint, initially I needed a place to put it. So that started me doing monotypes. So I would just put it on a piece of paper. And then I started using that same application method on paintings. And then you can move pretty much paint around all over the painting and to other paintings and then to pieces of paper. So it becomes a big industry in itself. But the figures were printed many, many times. And eventually the paint becomes very light and feathery. So you can see the layers beneath it. And it'll slowly, over many, many printings, build up a texture.
Do you have some images of your project wall? Did you bring any of those?
I did, yeah. There's another. Oh, these are drawings that I did from fashion models that were walking. And I did it on a
on-site?
Yeah. I did it on a translucent piece of paper, actually theatrical gel.
Almost looked like leather.
And then I taped it to the wall, and then I added a piece of Saran wrap that had been part of that printmaking process. So on the paint-colored Saran wrap, once I printed it, I use a spoon instead of a press, but it adheres to the paper differently than to the cutout, so it leaves an imprint of the model. But I kind of wanted to develop this as photographic images. I mean, now this just exists taped to my window, but I'm thinking about, I wonder if I could make tintypes out of this somehow. Here's a postcard painting.
How big are those?
4 by 6. Or
inches?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a regular... you know, when you used to, back in the 40s, you used to travel and see sites.
Yeah.
They always had copies of images of the site.
Yeah.
I used to collect them.
I had pretty many too as a kid.
Back in the 40s I did anyway.
You still have them?
No. I should. It would be neat.
I've got some of your show that I'm going to do what? Paintings on. I have some of your show postcards.
Oh.
I'm going to do paintings on them. There's another one on top of one of my show cards.
Yeah, the stack, the bottom part is the stack of pigment, right?
Yeah, this is a piece.
Just like one pancake on top of another.
If you turn this upside down, it's a a show card. It's a picture of the piece that I had at the small work show. And it's a little shelf covered with linen and stacks of oil paint skins. It's about, 5 inches tall? So that gives you an abstracted idea of the sculptural pieces. Let's see where this... Oh, this is one of the models. This, I just shot this.
Did you do the drawing on her?
No, this was backstage in hair and makeup, and this was one of the designs for one of the shows. I didn't have anything to do with the makeup, but I feel like this is a good sort of paint no evil symbol. And I want to use this in a project, this particular image. But yeah, the models are definitely working their way into my work. Here is an example that reminds me of the project wall, in that I also did a wall-sized piece in Gallery Sensei this summer. It was a photo show. And I felt like the piece, it wasn't really a photography piece, it was an installation, because I didn't do the photography, I didn't do the development myself. I just sent them away and got the prints. So I felt like the objects, the single objects, weren't really that valuable to me, but the expression of the idea worked out, and that was valuable. This is a photo montage I did in college that was just sitting around for years in the basement, and I could have gotten rid of it, but I ended up taking it I took it upstate to my friend, the family home of my friend Andy. And they have an abandoned house, which they mostly use for storage, and which I use as a studio when I go up there and landscape paint. But there's a bathroom in there that doesn't work. So I put this piece up in there, in the bathroom, and now I feel like it's complete and meaningful. And no one's ever gonna see it, but that's where it is.
Isn't the German painter who made Mertz paintings? I'm trying to think of his name now, but I can't, because I haven't used his name.
Yeah, was he like one of the Dada artists or?
Yes. He was German, and he built a whole house.
Yeah.
That was put together by him, so to speak. Or it became his house.
Yeah.
And they called it Mertz, M-E-R-T-C.
Yeah, I remember. I remember studying him. Can't remember his name, though. So this, you were talking about folding one ingredient into the next piece or next series. These are portraits that I took, and this is a picture of the computer screen. This was the layout for the installation I did at Gallery Sensei. It was called Twilight, and there was a video screen in the middle. But I used a lot of these portraits in the project wall now, but I cut them up and sanded them. I sort of drew into them with sandpaper and covered them in acrylic, so now I'm able to paint on them. So now I've kind of integrated them into another painting in a way that I feel a little bit better about in terms of having manipulated the object in a meaningful way. This is the stretcher for the project wall. So I wanted to have a stretched toned primed canvas to bring here. So I built it in a wood shop, and then I drove it on the highways of New York to Far Rockaway. Luckily late at night.
Oh.
Oops. This is a detail of the project wall, which is in progress now.
Yeah, where you can see the images that you've cut out.
Yeah, there's cut out
on the wall, and then you've painted around them and tried to integrate them within the space, your way of integrating them. These are the rectangular forms are acetate, aren't they?
I guess you'd call it that. Yeah, it's theatrical gel for coloring the lights. They're like filters. But I sit and watch the models come down the runway and draw composite drawings, because they don't stand still, so
no.
To get one drawing, it takes like 5 models. But I did a lot of them, and now they're forming a big diagonal in the piece. The fire are actually pictures of hands. And you can see some of the bather cutouts. The portraits become sky elements. So yeah, I'm taking a lot of stuff, a lot of ingredients, and turning it into a project.
Okay, let's bring on another one. Do you have another image of your wall, or what is the next one?
The next one is, it's actually a digital piece that I did for, it was for a piece of music called The Three Enigmas by Jose Bevia.
Well, before we go to that, you can come until about the 13th, 12th, 13th, it's a Sunday. It ends on a Sunday.
Of April.
Of April. And you can see it as it moves from this to whatever it is that it becomes.
Yeah, it's. I've got a good start. It's interesting now. And
yeah, you spent 25 hours on that or something like that. So there's a lot of time. And he doesn't live around the corner. He lives up in Queens, right?
Yes. The theme is the Vivian girls grow up. They're characters invented by Henry Darger, who people refer to as an outsider artist who worked from the early to middle 20th century, maybe even latter half of the 20th century. But I definitely think of that theme as a point of departure. But anybody interested in Henry Darger might be interested in seeing it, see what I make of his world.
Okay, let's see your...
This is another piece that it was projected, and it was one piece for each movement of a world premiere of contemporary classical music at Merkin Concert Hall. And it's another piece that kind of only has a life digitally. I don't really know. I don't think I would be satisfied with it if it were printed. I'm kind of looking for a way.
This is called the digital age, isn't it?
Yeah. Looking for a way to come up with an indelible photographic image. And I'm wondering if something like this could be turned into a tintype. I guess you'd have to create a transparency first.
Do you have another image?
I think that might be it. Oh, tape drawings.
What's this?
These are paint, oil paint on artist's tape.
Yes, I'm so very familiar with that.
Whenever I mask anything, the edges of something, or sometimes I mask through a piece to preserve something that I like and don't want to paint over, I'll use the tape and then I'll save it and then I make it into a drawing.
back in the 70s, I did silk training, and it was all mask and tape. And then I would put it up and hang it from the ceiling. Mm-hmm. And I'd have this whole ceiling with these hanging down. I could see that right away.
Yeah. Yeah, it's another ongoing practice, and there are definitely artists before me that helped me understand that this is allowed and worthwhile. I should be keeping my tape.
In other words, all of it is part of the process.
It is, yeah. Try to use everything.
It's not a throwaway. It's not anything. It's part of the dialogue that you're collecting.
And it's beautiful. Yeah, just like doing video, going frame by frame, you realize that beauty is pretty much in every millisecond.
Do you have anything you would like to add before we call it an evening?
I think I've said all I need to say.
You mean, I got to wind you back up?
Maybe, yeah.
Well, thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you.
I would like to thank the audience for tuning in. I'd like to encourage you to come to the New Arts Program in Kutztown between now and the 12th, the Sunday of April. And I'm James Carroll, and good night.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts Program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.